specific tools and techniques to improve a website or a blog. So not all of this will work for each person, but it's pretty straightforward stuff. So my name is Rich Harrington. I have a company called Red Pixel, which is a visual communications company, and we also have a full studio called Media Factory, which is right behind the State Theater in Falls Church, for those of you who are local. So 7,000 square foot facility with a 4K studio and a photography studio. And these are some best practices. So we're going to focus on ways to improve a website, design, techniques, plugins, and I've been publishing to the web since 1996. 1996, right out of college, I ran a music magazine. We were publishing a concert calendar 2 years before Ticketmaster ever had one online. We were covering the music scene for Des Moines, Minneapolis, and Kansas City. I did the first interview, for those of you who are into hard rock, with Slipknot and Stone Sour well before they were big national bands. You know, it was a great music scene. I was right out of school. My day job was working as a video editor right next to a recording studio. We had great access to people. My day job had all the hardware. We were doing all of the video clips for the kiosks for Best Buys and the stores. So I was putting audio and video of unsigned bands up on the internet in 1996. So when I say that I have strong opinions, I have strong opinions because I've been doing it for 20 years, and I have screwed up more than most people have done. So if I say something like, don't do this, it's because it cost me a lot of money or it caused me problems. Now, you are free to follow any of the advice I give or ignore any of the advice I give. It's just that. It's what worked for me or what failed for me. But I do have strong opinions. So I'm a visual storyteller. My love is photography and video. And I keep myself busy. I've written about 40 books, laid down about 100 classes. I've been a teacher in town at the Art Institutes and at American University. I've now officially retired from teaching. And about 6 times a year, I go to conferences to speak just to try to help people. The rest of the time, I'm working on clients and projects or doing photography. My personal blog is Richard Harrington. That's where you'll find tons of resources and downloads. And everywhere else, I'm pretty easy to find. So this symbolizes my approach to the web. There are two kinds of people, those who do the work and those who take the credit. Try to be in the first group. There's less competition there. I try to genuinely create original content that helps people, inspires people, and makes their life better. I've been doing this for about 17 years. I've been publishing content online. Actually, about 19 years now. God, I'm getting old. And it is fascinating, the people I meet. My wife and children have finally figured out that it's not weird that we could be just about anywhere and someone will come up and say, thank you for your photography tutorials, or thank you for this, or I watch this, or I love this, thanks for helping me. And that's great. And as much of my stuff that's up there for pay, I have twice as much stuff up there for free. I always tell the people who pay for my stuff, thank you for sending my kids to college. They're not there yet. They're 8 and 11. College is expensive, so please keep subscribing. But everyone else, I'm glad I could help you. And so we put this stuff out there. So I try to help people out. My background is I'm a project management professional. I own a business. I make some time as a technical consultant. I get stuff out there. I'm very strategic and very tactical. I am better with that side of the brain than I am the creative side, but I enjoy the creative side. So I've worked with a lot of people, a lot of agencies, a lot of TV networks, a lot of cause groups to help them with the strategy. But what happens is I serve as a translator. This is why I'm an executive producer. This is why I own a studio and have employees, is that I can go to the really boring business meetings and sit there and completely understand the challenges and the marketing problems. And then I can go back and talk to the creatives and help them execute a vision that's beautiful and effective. I have picked up a lot of business through the years by going to companies that have award-winning videos and say, what sort of results did you get out of that video other than receiving an award from, you know, a Telly Award? Did that video produce any results for you? It's because there's a lot of creatives that just make pretty shit that has no message and no purpose. So that's my approach, and I love making content. I get to travel the world and take pretty pictures. I get to see awesome things. And it's fun. And I'm a visual storyteller. And I like to tell stories. I like to get to capture. I was a history minor. I was a journalism major. I love documenting stories. And when I could take that and I could capture those stories and put them into things like online education, like public service announcements. You can't hear this here because I'm plugged into the headphone port. That's right. But this is a PSA that we did for the American Diabetes Association to raise money for one of their biking events. And all of the people are real world people. There's not a single actor. This is all at a real event. You know, we shot at three different races. We went out, you know, got all the permits, got the people, did the shooting, documented the events, and put together commercials. And this commercial got over $30 million of earned media. That's a pretty good return on a $75,000 investment. So I believe that you need to balance out stuff. You need design. You need creativity. There's a lot of businesses out there, a lot of people in marketing departments, a lot of organizations that refuse to embrace creativity. I ask a lot of people working in corporations, when was the last time you painted something other than a wall in a house? Well, I'm not good at painting. It's not about being good. It's about releasing things in your brain. When was the last time you did a sculpture class? When was the last time you did hands-on non-digital media? We'll do this periodically for fun. I'll do this and take craft classes with kids. I am both a Boy Scout and a Girl Scout troop leader, and we do hands-on activities all the time. I build stuff. I make jewelry with my daughter. These are all artistic outlets. And it's important that you have those. Otherwise, you can't get results. So before I sound like some strange-looking hippie to you, I take this advice to really big companies and brands. I'm a communications consultant for some pretty big people that I solve technical and messaging problems for. So what I'm going to tell you is going to occasionally sound simplistic, but all of these 10 things have worked and have earned money, have made good positive returns. So if you can implement one or two of them, you will move your web property in the right direction. So people are absolutely overwhelmed with choices. Do you remember growing up as a kid when, you know, the choice was Cheerios and then maybe there was Honey Nut Cheerios? Next time you go to the store, look at how many flavors of Cheerios there are. Just Cheerios. You'll find at least 9. Frosted, cinnamon, apple cinnamon, honey nut, fruit. They look like Fruit Loops, but they're not. It's crazy. People are overwhelmed with choice. One of the things I tell a lot of our clients all the time is stop offering so many goddamn choices. You are confusing your audience. Give them one or two and then have a customized page. This is what Apple does, right? You go to their website and you want to buy a piece of technology. It's good, better, best. And then you make a couple of simple choices to add upgrades or downgrades as you choose. But if you go to buy a computer on Apple, there's basically a good, better, best option, and everything is decided for you. But for those who need control or precision, they can still do it. So you have to balance that out. So I do a lot of publishing. I publish a website called Photo Focus. I have a personal blog called Richard Harrington. We put out ebooks. I manage a Facebook group. And we learn a lot. Every day, I am publishing about 6 pieces of original content through my network. And every night, I sit down and analyze the performance, the comments, and the feedback that we've received. This is a key to succeeding. Looking at what works, what connects. Mobile, really, really big. Now, I recognize that as you look at this, this is the problem that most of us see, an empty slate, right? What am I going to write about today? What am I going to publish? It's not a problem. We do our publishing in bursts. I tell most of my writers to set aside a day and write all of their articles for the month that day. Because the amount of time they spend spinning up into content creation mode and then winding back down is huge. I'm like, get a cup of coffee, sit down on a Sunday morning, and just start writing and see how long it takes to get all three articles done. And for most of them, it's just a couple of hours. It's when you are sitting there going, well, what am I going to write about? What am I going to write about? I tell all of them to keep a log or a note or a Google Doc. And every time they have an idea for a story, put it in there. Then when they go, what am I going to write about? They go back to their article idea list and they pick one and they write. Creativity happens in burst. Now, if you need statistics to back up anything you're going to tell your boss, place number one, infinite dial. This is a survey and a report done by originally Arbitron, now a different group, but it's all about understanding traditional media and the impact on it. It is skewed to slightly make traditional media look better. So it's about understanding radio and television and that stuff. The Pew Internet Group is the Pew Research Center, filled with great information about politics, media, social trends, religion, internet, you name it. Wonderful website with lots of data, with good insight in articles. All right, strategy number one, add a community. People want to connect. So in your online communities, be genuine, be well-rounded, be passionate, be respectful, be an expert, take a stance, be involved with it, and be consistent. Make sure that people are timely. So in our Moving to Adobe Premiere Pro group, we've got about 14 moderators. None of them are getting paid anything, but they back each other up. They respond to things. They all have the ability to block trolls and people who are being mean or useless. They all understand the rules. And it's a very vibrant, active community. And those moderators occasionally pick up consulting jobs or jobs from it because they're helping people. It's amazing. You help people, and then eventually people who have big problems and budgets to go along with their problem call you up and say, can we hire you to help us? It actually does work. This is a photographer. He used to be head of the WPPI, the Wedding Portrait Photography Institute. He has a closed group for people who come to his workshops and consulting. And these people interact with each other all day long. People who made friends at these 3 and 4 day workshops who want to stay in touch with other people. I belong to a couple of groups for this, for some of these more residential conferences. I don't know if any of you had a chance to go to like a 3 or 4 day event, like the Editor's Retreat is one, where it's held at a resort and it's 5 days long and you're eating with everybody and you're spending all day with the same people. Well, those people often want to stay in touch afterwards. And so these communities work well. We have a closed group for Photo Focus where people get critiques on their photos, and then we take pictures and post them to our group and share them on the main website. We have one just for our contributors so they can see what's going on and talk with each other. I belong to communities over on Google+. This one's pretty active. This one's not that active. This one's in reserve for a future project. And this is great. I can get access to 33,000 people who are into Photoshop. So if I want to test out a new idea for a tutorial or an article, I could post a short, quick tip over there and see if people liked it. Oh yeah, I spent 5 minutes testing my content with a focus group of 33,000 people. Did anybody react? What was the feedback? Don't freak out if you only get 7 likes. Look to see how many other likes other things in the group has. Realize that less than 1% of all consumers like things or star things. We're not talking about like family members post. We're talking about business posts and groups. So this stuff works really well. To maintain those communities, again, listen. This is why we provide an email button so people can send an email that actually goes to me. I hate email, but I figure that I need to be reachable. I should not put up a giant thing where you have to fill out some form and enter a passphrase to send me an email message. If I'm going to publish a website and make money off of an audience, I need to be accessible. I make no qualms about you're going to get a response within a week, but I am accessible. I follow people who are good. For example, this is an important number. 20,000 followers following 1,700. I apply a rule that on Twitter, I should be following about 10% of the people that follow me. It's not mathematical. It's just I don't follow every person back. That person looks interesting. About once a month, I will go to my followers page and read through it and find anybody who looks interesting. And anybody who responds to my stuff more than once, or like they say, oh, I love this, and I say, oh, I love, you know, thank you for that, and we have a short conversation, I almost always follow them back. Oh, they have a pulse, they're polite, they can write a couple of coherent sentences. Yes, we share a common interest, we should follow each other. It's only a Twitter follow, for God's sakes. It's not like they're seeing pictures of your kids. Facebook, totally different. Please don't try to hit the 5,000 limit for friends on Facebook. It's not worth trying to have 5,000 friends. Have 500 or 600 real friends, if that many. So you can see who's following. You can see who's responding. And I'll periodically roll over these. And if I see somebody important, like a brand or a thought leader that I recognize, I'll immediately follow them back. You curate content. So we have different authors and contributors. We're looking for good stuff. Sometimes comments will come in and people will have really good stuff. Like, oh, hey, I used to be a model and this is our take on makeup. Sometimes I'll get guest posts just by reading through our comments and finding great ideas or people to be guests on the podcast or to write a guest article. On YouTube, be very careful with your comments, but you can send messages and you actually get some incredible insight. YouTube has scary statistics. So does Facebook. They could tell you a whole lot about your audience and your reach. It is, if you have never tried to run Facebook ads, even if you don't intend to run ads, run some ads and only target people who like your Facebook page, and you will see an incredible profile of their locations, their finances, their age, and their gender breakdown. And you can even target other people who like other companies' products and get competitive analysis on who those people pull in. It's fascinating and downright scary. So you try to help people, and then you put your original content out. All right, I'm going to move on to strategy two. Any questions or comments on strategy one? Increase the visuals. 54% of adult users are posting original photos or videos online that they created. Half of all internet users are putting stuff up. That was a 10% jump in 1 year. And that was back in 2013. They haven't revved this study. I'm going to wager that this is probably up to 65 or 75% now. Photography has become a replacement for text on the internet. This isn't a good thing necessarily, but think of the number of people that will post a status update by taking a picture or a selfie or share something and then add a one-sentence caption. Totally becoming a new way of communicating because everyone's walking around with internet-connected cameras and it's just faster and easier. People don't read. What happens is they read things if the photo caught their eye. Find yourself going to Twitter and scroll through. You will stop when you see a good Twitter icon, but more likely you will stop when you see a visual that catches your eye. Visual interest stops people in their place and they will read the article. It's not the headline. It's usually the picture that gets them to stop. Layout is important. Making sure that the article is easy to understand. So you can use pictures to break up a really long article to keep pulling people through. As they read and they start to get eye fatigue, they see a pretty picture. Oh, and they look at the picture and the brain relaxes for a moment. It's like an interval climber on a stair climber. It's like running, 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 sprint. Okay, slow, catch your breath. The pictures are an opportunity for people to switch to a different part of their brain. And for SEO, if you rename your files descriptive names, this helps enormously because don't just have generic file names. Have descriptive file names so that that actually is part of the file name because that improves the SEO for the website. You can also put alt tags and other things in. Plus, Google Image Search is a very popular way. There are tons of times that I go searching for a picture of something and I find a great picture for something is often accompanied by a great article. Google Image Search is a really popular way for people to search, and that often leads to really good articles. So people are much more likely to read if your post has an article or have images in it. Always use the alt tag to describe the image. Don't take stuff that you don't have the rights to. You can get things from public domain, government, Wikipedia, Commons, Flickr. There are tons of assets on Wikipedia that are free to use. There are tons of things on Flickr. You can go to cc.org or go to Creative Commons, and there is a search engine to search for public domain photos that people have decided to offer up in the public domain. There is no shortage of free photography. Do not steal photographs from photographers. Don't think I could just apologize or I can claim fair use. You will lose a lot of money in doing so. Yeah?
So like an image that maybe a studio or something that has put out a movie or a set or something, using those, how can you tell whether it's a photo that's okay to use? Or
well, how are you using it to comment or review the movie or the article? That's fine. That's editorial use, and you're making fair comment. Are you using it to say, my studio is just like this one. It's under construction. Invest in my studio. Here's my new green screen set. It's going to be just like this one. No, then you're using that image for commercial use, and you're misrepresenting. So, you know, there's a thing, you know, you can look up the concept of fair use, and there's a great fair use comic book out there. Fair use is a valid defense, but it has to be genuinely used where you are commenting or critiquing the original work while providing absolute link back. So it's not fair use for you to take somebody else's picture and put it in your blog post that's marketing your cause or organization. It is totally fine to take five other people's photography and write an article about five famous photographers and show their pictures if you're providing proper citation and you are doing it in a way that follows it. It's also never a bad idea to just ask for permission anyways. It's the professional thing to do. But royalty-free is quite good. A lot of folks don't realize that right inside Adobe Creative Cloud, you have two areas. One are assets. Everything under assets is free to use. There's some photography. There's a ton of things like product shots, book shots, phones, things like you can make something look like it was a book or an app on a screen or like put the website on an iPad, like just take a screenshot and embed it. And they're often layered files and templates. They're totally designed for designers and ease to use. And all of this stuff is included in your Creative Cloud membership, and Adobe pays the creators money when the stuff is used. People agree to put their stuff in here, and Adobe pays for it. You get it as part of your membership. Adobe also bought Fotolia and rolled it into their stock area, and so there's stock built right into the Adobe apps. Now, there are other solutions out there for stock photography too, but this is just showing you that content is merging with the creation tools as well. So Adobe Stock, ton of images. You can get content. On my own website, if you click on resources and free images, I have a link to several government websites offering free high-quality photographs that you have already paid for with your tax dollars that you are free to use in projects as long as you provide proper credit. There are some wonderful things out there. Like, for example, the CIA World Factbook has incredible maps and flags and all sorts of great images of almost every country in the world that were paid for, that you can use, because they're part of the government assets. Okay. Another thing you can do to dramatically improve a website is add more voices. One drop makes a ripple. Lots of drops creates waves. So you need to keep things going. So you look at the competition, you figure what's out there, you think about who do you want to attract to your website or your organization, and you recruit outside people to fill in those holes. So we have a bunch of companies that license our articles or commission some of my writers to write articles. Here's a great example. Have any of you guys ever heard of Drobo? They make hard drives. So Drobo had a big falling out with Scott Kelby, who was a longtime supporter, had a problem, and he wrote an article called While I'm Done with Drobo. So if you search on Drobo and Photography or Drobo and Photographer, the number one article is a very famous photographer saying why he's never going to use them again and why. It is terrible for them and has cost them a lot of money. Do you want to know what the number two article is? It's an article written by a guy who's not very famous, a guy named Robert Vanelli. Very nice guy, great photographer, super nice guy. It's all on 3-2-1 backup. It's how to keep your pictures safe and not lose data. And he uses it with a Drobo, but he shows how you could do this with any hard drive, but explains the extra benefits of doing it with a Drobo. Yeah, he still puts his stuff on two hard drives and one up to the cloud, and each hard drive is set up that something can fail and he won't lose data. It's the number two article. It ran on their blog, but it was written by a guest expert as a guest post. Because nothing is better than your own website for the key term. So how do we get the number two search result with zero paid placement, with zero keywords or Google search juice? We simply took an article about a problem that all photographers have, hired a nice photographer who's not super famous, who does this for a living and is very passionate about keeping his images backed up, and had him write a useful article and put it on the manufacturer's website. And that's the number two article, outperforming anything else on their website about Drobos and photography. Yeah.
It just won Scott Kelby's
number three. Oh, is it? Good. Thank you. What's probably funny is there, after I pointed this out to them, maybe they did pay to juice it. I wouldn't be surprised if now they are. Okay, good. So, but this is a normal Google search that this was the number two hit. And so it's important. Guest posts can be incredibly impactful. Having a guest celebrity in where maybe you do a profile on some famous person who's in the space. Or you take somebody that was in your documentary and you do a short story about them and use it to promote the documentary. This stuff is gold. Search engines love it. And so it gets stuff on your website. I don't need a bunch of posts from Joe McNally, who's the most popular photographer on the planet, to help my website. He's on the podcast about once a quarter. He probably writes six times a year for me. But it's fantastic to have him on the website. But I need writers like Vanelli who write six times a month. Spark fuel. Now, you don't get to be a fire starter overnight. Joe's done tons of great content, tons of work. He's paid dues. He's shot for Life magazine, Time, Newsweek, you name it. I mean, he has been out there in the field working hard as a professional for 30 plus years. So every bit of success he has, he's earned. But two college kids, two guys right out of college. Want to know what's fascinating? He can get numbers just as good as him sometimes with the right article. Because on the internet, no one cares if you're famous. Search engines care. Most readers don't care. They don't distinguish between the authors. That's usually the third thing they notice is who wrote something. Which is why so much bullshit makes its way through the internet. It's because nobody fact checks or looks for anything. It's not journalism. So, here's some examples of articles that have resonated. Kevin Ames wrote an article about makeup for men. Like, if you're going to put a man on camera, why you should consider having a makeup artist and what you need to know. And he used himself as the model in the article. Just say, look, I got to practice what I preach. And here's me without makeup. And here's me after a professional makeup artist. And look at how it solved his problems with the shine and how it helped with some of the bags under my eyes. So that totally resonates. Look at our authors, right? Here's me. Here's the founder of the website who's semi-retired. My number two author is a 38-year-old woman. She's fantastic. She is so passionate. She's published about 10 books. She's a former Marine. She never finished college. She has no degree in photography whatsoever. She has never been to art school. She was a Marine who got into photography, and after she got out of the service, just kept shooting. And she's our number three author. He's a black belt who owns a karate studio and shoots half-time. This is a young guy who used to be one of our fans and readers who just kept volunteering and offering to help at our events. And we said, would you like to write something? And he's good. Never would have known it, but we gave him a chance because he was one of our biggest fans. This is my photo assistant. She's a mom of four. And she only shoots half time. The rest of the time, she's raising her kids. And she totally connects with people. Because when she writes about her struggles with something, tons of other women can relate to the challenges that she has as a mom of four and wants to make better pictures. When Nicole writes a post about how so many camera bags piss her off because the straps smash her chest and they're ugly and she doesn't need another goddamn pink bag, it's a genuine rant and it's funny and I could never write it. You have to have different voices, otherwise you will only attract people who are the less good version of you. If you're the only voice on your website, you're only going to attract people like yourself. You have to diversify. One of my friends, Lisa, who's a professional wedding photographer in town, her husband is Ian, if any of you have been taking some of the After Effects classes here. He's a great designer. He used to be at the Discovery Channel. She, you know, never wanted to be in the limelight, but I knew her, and she shot some photos for one of my books. I'm like, would you please write for my website? I'm not a writer. I'm like, you are a woman who has had her own wedding business for 9 years. You started your own business. You own your own company. You have tons of awards. There are tons of people who want to hear from you. One of her most successful articles was just this. Would you stop wearing high heels and shooting weddings? If you're going to be shooting at an event, just wear comfortable shoes. It was a rant about people being stupid and this pressure for women who are working in video and photography production to dress up and wear high-slit skirts and high heels while trying to man a camera. It went really well. Could I write that article? No. Would I even think of that as an issue? No. So, my writing staff has 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 women on it. That's pretty high for a photography website to be a third female writers. Male-dominated industry. We have 4 people who are over the age of 55. We have 4 people who are under the age of 30. Why? Because I want everybody who loves photography to feel welcome at this place. So it is important that when people look in the mirror, they see themselves on your website. Right? We have people of all ethnicities on my website who are authors. It is important that you actively recruit people of different backgrounds and experiences to share. We have 2 people who have Pulitzer Prizes. We have a couple of people who can barely figure out how to keep their 4 kids in school and not failing at life and are lucky to have 6 hours to shoot pictures a week. But they love photography and they want to share what they've learned with others. And all of that content resonates. You don't need a team of all-stars. So, another thing you could do, yeah, go ahead. That's a whole complex model, but we do profit sharing. We take 25% of all our revenue that comes in and distribute that based back to all the writers based on viewership. And our owners don't take any content from that split. So the people that are who are taking an owner stake don't take any of that money. And so it's based purely on productivity. And every one of our writers can see the exact same statistics on how everybody is doing. And they all know which of those they're making. And they all have the exact same contract that they helped develop. And everyone has the same deal. Nobody gets a different royalty rate. So congratulations, you get paid the same as Joe McNally. All you have to do is get the same amount of traffic as Joe McNally. And you know what? Sometimes people do. Joe's not the number one author. He's the most famous one. Right? I'm a socialist capitalist. I believe, having been on welfare myself, having my mom lose her job and being on welfare for 3 years, I believe that societies need to have a certain level of infrastructure. And having been screwed and having bad contracts, I believe that the playing field needs to be fair. But I believe that those who work hard and those who kick ass should make more money. So I'm a social capitalist. Does that make sense? Everyone's treated the same way. The ones who perform better get more out of it. And the ones who don't still make something. I got people who are thrilled. A couple of those moms are totally thrilled that every quarter they're making about $800 off of about nine articles, right? Making about $100 an article. They're thrilled. $900 goes a long way. An extra $4,000 a year for your hobby, it's great. Other people make a lot more. Social sharing. It is important to allow for sharing via social media. Now, these are the statistics from Edison. Their numbers are a little more conservative. Edison is focused on television content. The important thing here is this. Snapchat is scary. Pinterest and Instagram you need to pay attention to. Not Instagram and Pinterest, but the reason why Instagram and Pinterest are so popular is it's all about photography. Pinterest resonates with women incredibly well. Huge numbers. And what happens is people go to boards. Women particularly will go to boards of content organized by usually other women and visually browse, see something of interest, and click. And oftentimes that will take them someplace else to a blog or a website. But it is a visual card catalog of curated topics made by people. Here are some of my favorite things. Percentage of users in the U.S. 62% of all Americans over the age of 13 use Facebook, according to the Infinite Dial. Pew Internet Life puts that at 71% for Facebook users. So this is what Pew Internet says, so you see there's a slight difference. As I said earlier, statistics lie. There are so many factors that affect statistics, and nobody has adequate sample sizes anymore. But this is still useful to see. And for God's sakes, start using LinkedIn more.
That's surprising.
It is. 28% of all people have a profile that they use on LinkedIn. Yeah. But the thing is LinkedIn is not useful if you don't have the paid version of LinkedIn. The paid version of LinkedIn sends me a report every day of who looked at my profile. And I could see potential customers who are going to be calling me in the next 2 or 3 days. I could see when my competition is scoping out what we're doing. I could see when former people that I've worked with before are probably going to be entering the job market. And I appear to have psychic powers because by their stalking me, I get a report. Now, if you're a paid member on LinkedIn, you can make your browsing activity public. But everybody else, it's public, and the people who have paid memberships get intel on who's looking at your stuff. So I can't tell who else you've looked at, but I could tell everybody who's looking at me, and I could be ready for when those phone calls come. Oh, hey, I was just thinking about you the other day. It's so great. Yeah, I was thinking about that project we did. What's going on? And you've already mentally prepped, and you're ready for that phone call, and you sound like a freaking genius. I'm not psychic. I use LinkedIn. So But the younger groups have a lot more on social media. Once people leave the house and they're allowed to, we're looking at about 90% on social media. So a lot of use for social media, a ton of people out there. Remember, the outlets are this. Twitter, Facebook, Google+, and LinkedIn are general outlets. This is where people go who just want to share and consume content. If you are looking for creators networks, you post here. So if you want to get people who are creating content, then you target these groups because this is where content creators go. So if you're trying to do a user-generated contest, if you're trying to attract people who utilize technology or are using paid tools, this is where you go. So when we want to help a software manufacturer who makes plugins for photographers, what are we going to do? Oh, I'll go to Facebook and I'll say, show my ad only to people who have a college degree, who are over the age of 28 but under the age of 60, who graduated from college, who are employed, who like any of these following 20 cameras or manufacturers that make these high-end cameras, and only show it to people who have uploaded a picture to Facebook. Click-through rates of about 7 to 8%. That's a pretty good click-through rate on an ad. Normal click-through rates, like 2%, people are thrilled. Through targeting, 8%. Facebook is scary. If you have not looked at the advertising engine, go home tonight and see how specific you can get. For example, we did an open house targeted to government employees at my office. I targeted people who worked at 20 government agencies, who had master's degrees, who were over the age of 40. And with spending about $200, I got 75 people to an event. That is fascinating to me. I was able to target people by zip code. And all of this stuff is offered up for free by people because they love the addiction of social media. It is scary how much they know. So you have to turn that on. You have to start tying your websites to social media so that comments, so the next version of our website launching next year, we'll be using a commenting system. So if a user logs in through Facebook and connects their account, it'll automatically post their comments and stuff to their wall. So if they decide to share something to Facebook, it'll ask them to authorize it, and then in the future, it will start sharing content. They could turn it off, but there's a little checkbox that's checked by default that says share this. They can uncheck it. It's not hidden. They don't have to go into some preference. But the default that we enable is share. You'll be amazed at how many people never change the default settings on anything. So you put it right in their face that they could disable social sharing, but you make social sharing the default, and hey, guess what? You will have more social shares. I know that this sounds simplistic, but this is human behavior. If you don't want to change human behavior, make the behavior you want the default behavior, and you will have more people that do it. Okay? I shared this in the previous session, but this is true. This is a joke, but it's true. Do you want anybody to see it? No. Post it to Google+. Google+ has failed now 3 times. Started as Buzz. It just failed again. They have killed Photos and moved it into its own product, and they have moved Google Hangouts into its own product. Photos and Hangouts were the only 2 things good about Google+. Everything else was no different than other social networks, and people didn't want a third social network. Foursquare. Are you in a bar? Post to Foursquare. Well, Foursquare has actually become incredibly useful. Foursquare is my favorite app for restaurant reviews. You want to know why? Unlike Yelp and everything else, you have to be within 100 feet of the venue to post a comment. My father used to own a health club. Hey, we'd like to help you out with your social optimization. We can drum up user reviews for you on Yelp. No, thank you. I'm not interested. 2 weeks later, oh, we noticed you have a lot of negative reviews. And some of these reviews were things like, the pool has algae in it. He doesn't have a goddamn pool in his health club. There are entire people who just post negative reviews to businesses and then call businesses to post positive reviews or get paid by businesses. And if you scroll through on Yelp, you will see the same review posted over and over again or 20 reviews by the same person. It's bullshit. Foursquare is the only one that actually requires geolocation. So if you're out and about and you're looking for a restaurant or you're at a restaurant and you want to know what dessert is good or what appetizers are good, seriously, launch the Foursquare app and read the comments. It's amazing. But it's only good for one thing, and that is food and alcohol. Everything else, it's pointless to post to Foursquare. Is it business related? Yes. Would it be awkward to explain to your boss? Yes, don't post. Is it business? No. Is it personal? Yes. Great. Would it be awkward to explain to your parents? Yes. Don't post. No. Great. Do you need a bunch of people to tell you they like it? Okay. Post it to Facebook. Do you actually want intelligent people who want to do things and take action? Post it to Twitter. Twitter is the most educated, socially active audience that actually does stuff. But Twitter has almost as much recognition as Facebook, but about a fifth as many users. But the user quality is so much higher. People on Twitter are the most active. Half of all people on Twitter actively follow brands and companies and will reshare and republish and retweet and tell people about stuff. Twitter is a personalized newsfeed. Go to Twitter to get information. Go to Facebook to connect and feel social. Not social. Socially filtered news. Social. Okay? So, there are a lot of plugin comments available for WordPress. There are lots of other plugins available out there. Many other web platforms will have social commenting. But investigate what comment structure you can turn on and look for something that ties into social media so that people log in and have to validate their identity with the social media account, and that will trigger posts and likes more easily. So people can comment, you reply back, that's great. You want people to be able to share content. What's weird is that Twitter won't feed back a number for the number of tweets, but on Facebook and LinkedIn, I could totally see the number of people who've shared a particular article. This is great intel. Start filtering your blog post by the most shared content, and now you start seeing what people are excited about. Much more useful than stars. All right, any questions before we go forward to the next thing? Live events. Bring people together in real time. People love to come together live, in person or not. We do a Google Hangout almost every week, different topics. We have one on Lightroom. We have one on HDR photography. We'll do special event ones. Google offers 100% free webcasting. Google Hangouts are completely free, no cost to you. You can schedule them. You can set them to private and invite only. You can set them to have an RSVP list. You can only invite people by email. You can paste in a bunch of email addresses and make it a totally private event. The only thing you can't do is capture leads via email from it. But with most of the other hosting platforms costing between $1 and $7 a user to hold a webinar, this is pretty viable. Here's the thing that I love. So besides just being great content, as soon as we're done, yeah.
What's the practical limitation on number of attendees? If they're just interested in receiving only?
Very, none, because you know what the back end? The back end's YouTube. Do you think YouTube has robust servers?
Yeah. I mean, is that a viable alternative to Ustream if you're doing like professional?
I use it all the time. You can't brand it. So, you know, you can't brand it and put up as many gateways and other things. So, you know, I'm doing something for a pharmaceutical company. I'd absolutely use a Ustream or an AnyStream or a Livestream. Totally. Right? Hey, this is for a closed audience. This is for investors.
And it can appear on your website.
Right. But this can be appearing too. You just take the YouTube player and embed it. It's an embeddable player. It even puts up a countdown to how much time before the event is going to start. And you can have up to 10 panelists. You get a switching environment so you can switch between. And here's the part that almost nobody knows. You know, besides using real microphones and you know, using lights, you know, it's pretty awesome. These guys will just do like live podcasts. It's pretty cool. You guys know what this box is? This is a $149 box from Blackmagic. Do you know what it does? You can jack in an SDI signal or an HDMI cord. And you know what's on this end? Thunderbolt. And when I plug it in on YouTube, I can just select that as my camera input source. So now both of my studios in my office can be live streaming on the internet for $149. Any client who can't come to the shoot, we could set up a private Google Hangout and they can invite the people who couldn't come from the remote office and invite people to watch the video shoot happening live. Hey, we're sitting down to interview this guest. Would you like to watch the interview live? And so we can do video production and live stream it to the clients or the decision makers on a private channel. And if you set it to private, YouTube leaves it as private. Yeah.
Have you seen those with USB 3?
They do have USB 3, and the USB 3 ones are about $600 for the ones that have an SDI, and the Thunderbolt only ones about $400 or $350. Thunderbolt, the reason why is that it takes more hardware in the device, whereas the Thunderbolt puts a lot of that onto the port, onto the computer. But Blackmagic does make USB 3 ones if you don't have Thunderbolt. I have not tested to see if they work with YouTube. They might. Yeah.
This may be too off topic, but if you were using Google Hangout for, say, a webinar with three different panelists, but you only need to hear the voices,
you can kill the cameras.
They're somewhere, wherever, and they don't have microphones, but they could be on a telephone.
You can, but there's a Hangouts app that you can install on a smartphone, and they could just dial in right from the smartphone with the headset. So, and if they're on an internet connection, it usually sounds better. Voice over IP always sounds better these days than phone lines.
Yeah.
So you get them on a Wi-Fi connection, you have them download the Hangout app, you send them an invite, they click the link in their email, it launches, and they're added as a panelist. And you, on the control panel, the person running the event, can live switch, can mute people's mics, can cut, decide when you cut to them. It's got a whole live switcher environment for software. It's beautiful. It's free. It is the most incredible thing that Google has made in 5 years. Now, I'm sure they've done other things that are cool, but yeah. It used to be buggy as shit. Now, we're using it every week these days. It's fantastic. The only thing that's frustrating is it's amazing how many times you can click the invite button and people don't get it. What I always do is I click the invite button, copy the link, and send people a text message and an email saying, click this, because depending upon how it shows up, it might pop up there as a message. If they don't use their Gmail account, it might be going into the bulk message folder. So I always actively invite people very quickly to make sure that they get the link. And we always start 20 minutes before the event starts. So there's enough time for everybody to get logged in and settled and make sure their connection is working. So it's not a last minute of people having technical problems. All right. Make more audio and video content on your website. What's fascinating is the growth in online radio. Online music listenership is just spiked. These numbers are huge. This is what Pandora and Apple Radio and Spotify, all of these things are just booming. More than half of all Americans have listened to radio on the internet. Some of the most effective ads out there right now are Spotify and Pandora ads. Cell phone listenership is crazy. My wife I keep telling her to please cancel her XM radio account because she got a new car a year and a half ago, and she still hasn't activated her XM radio because she just plugs in her phone with our unlimited data plan and uses Pandora because it's built in. And I'm like, that's great. Could you please kill XM radio? My wife, who's a school teacher, who goes to special education meetings all the time and has awkward conversations with parents about their kids, does not, she has a fear of talking to a customer service rep on the phone. So unless I log in and make the phone call for her and then say, they're going to be like, sir, can we please talk to the person on the account? Yeah, just a second. Do you verify that? You can say, yes. And she'll quickly hand the phone back. It's pathetic. If it involves anything stressful like canceling a credit card, I'm the one who has to do it. So as you look at the demographics by age, it's just booming. And this is from that Infinite Dial report. And so smartphone on the go is huge. And a lot of cell phone companies, like I think T-Mobile just did this, streaming audio and video is now exempt from the data plans. That's becoming a competitive point. They're making things like Netflix and Pandora free. They charge a little more. We will use, any of you guys familiar with SoundCloud? SoundCloud's great. So this is like the YouTube of audio, except you could totally brand it. You can control if there's stats. You can embed it in websites. It works on mobile devices. It allows you to feed in audio into a lot of other platform apps. It works on all the blogging platforms. And so it allows you to take your audio interviews and content and put it right into the blog post beautifully. You can allow downloads right from there. You can allow subscriptions. So if you're doing internet radio or audio content, this is fantastic. And for a lot of folks targeting low bandwidth, stop making video the only choice. If you're producing a public affairs show or magazines or educational content, you might consider making an audio-only version available because it'll work in lots of places that the video version won't. Yeah. Oh, there's a ton of great artists up there just sharing their stuff. And yeah, I mean, it's a well-known secret. So, yeah, if you don't spend time on SoundCloud and you're into different music and genres, go. It's fantastic.
But if you search for pop artists.
Right. Another thing is that web-connected TVs have grown really popular. Two-thirds of all people have an internet-connected television now. This means that your content needs to work. But 60% of people said that they would get rid of their television before their smartphone. So in the future, more and more people are going to be watching TV on things like this than on giant displays. The whole reason why TV manufacturers that did 4K and OLED displays and 3D and everything else is to try to get an experience that you can't get on this. And what do those people do? Okay, fine. You want a bigger screen? Have a bigger screen. And now when I play something on this, it's actually loud enough that I can just watch a movie. So I can watch a movie in my hotel room and kick back while I'm doing some work on the laptop, and I could totally use this. And I put the cell card in it so that I could use this as a mobile hotspot when I need it for my laptop. And when I'm on an airplane, I could use this with incredible battery life and check email, and it lasts for about 8 to 12 hours. And I use the laptop when I have to create. When I have to consume and correspond, I use a tablet. When I have to create, I use a laptop. And not everybody's a creator. So as you go down, this is what people said they would have a hard time giving up. Notice, people say they would not have a hard time giving up social media. I cry bullshit. Social media is totally an addiction. It feeds into every addictive tendency. It's the same reason why I spend way too much money buying credits for Star Wars Card Trader and downloading digital cards, and why I play the coin drop game that's exactly like the one at the arcade where you feed the quarters in and it pushes them off. And I play the virtual one. And so far, I am proud of myself for only spending 20 real dollars on virtual shit for a game because I justified that the last time I went to an arcade, I spent $20 and an hour on that game. But at least there, I win some prizes that the kids take. I get it. And I'm just going to be honest here, right? My family has a bunch of addicts in it. I'm not straight edge, but I don't do drugs and I do very limited alcohol because on my one side of my family, one of my family sides, there was five siblings. Between the five siblings, seven divorces and two people dead from drugs or alcohol use. I avoid the shit, but I totally know I have addictive personalities and I have things that I'm addicted to. I read 30 bucks of comic books a week. Now, I bill enough an hour that my wife doesn't care about my small addictions. She figures it's better that I spend 30 bucks a week reading comic books being totally tame. It's not my wife calling. That's good. I was like, wait a minute. Let's make sure that she doesn't have that good of ears. So, but that's the thing. Internet TV is the same way. The new Apple TV is beautiful. Now that they've integrated the games into it, it's really interesting as a platform. It's really starting to take off as a gaming platform. They ported a couple of Wii games to it, and they play just as well as they do on my Wii. Chromecast, Roku, the Fire Sticks, try to find a Blu-ray player that's not internet connected. My mom, when she moved from Chicago to DC, could not believe how expensive cable TV was. I convinced her to drop cable TV. I couldn't convince her to drop her landline phone. She, no, I have to have it. What about emergency? I'm like, she insisted. Fine. She was so freaked out. She has an Apple TV. We got Amazon Prime hooked up. Between Amazon Prime, Apple TV, and Netflix, she's got Hulu and Netflix. And she can get Amazon Prime if she needs it. For the 20 bucks a month she spends, she has no shortage of content. She's like, I can get the news. I just watch it the next morning. And there's no commercials. I'm like, yeah. She's like, and if it's really important, it pops up on my phone and I just watch it there. Yeah. I got my mom off of Court TV. She used to just watch that shit all day long. Watching television about murderers and rapists and crap and gossip TV. And now she's watching story-based content. And it's great. She's telling me about movies she's watching and content. Netflix is more popular than YouTube. And this was last year that it passed it. Netflix has more distribution. But keep in mind, 44% for Netflix, 43% were using YouTube, but still 27% using Hulu, which is pretty surprising. The big one here that's really growing is Amazon. If you are not paying attention to what Amazon is doing as a company, it is fascinating. And start integrating Amazon into your website, from purchases to everything else. So pretty straightforward stuff. But you have to figure out where you're going to put all of this video. So you got to think about the performance that you need. Doesn't need to be private. I basically tell most folks, use Vimeo if you can afford it. You're not giving up any of your intellectual property. When you say delete this from the server, it goes down. On YouTube, let's say your organization posted a video and then you no longer sold that product and you went to kill the video or there was a mistake and you deleted the video. Do you think if you hit delete, the video is gone? Your version of the video is gone. Anybody else who reshared that video, you have the ability to take an existing video on YouTube, republish it, and add your own comments or markers over it, or they can add it to their channel. That version doesn't get deleted when you hit delete. YouTube terms of service pretty much say, thanks, it's ours. That's the short version if you talk to a lawyer. You have zero rights whatsoever to that content. So don't put it up there if you care about that. Amazon S3 is pretty good. Libsyn is great for podcasts. Podbean, Cashfly, these are all pretty viable. I like Libsyn a lot for audio podcasts. They're okay for video podcasts. They have unlimited bandwidth plans based upon how much storage you need a month. So a great way to distribute a podcast. I know for $40 a month, I can upload my new episodes, and it doesn't matter how popular they are, my bandwidth never changes. Podbean is similar. Unlimited video, $18 a month with unlimited storage. Okay? So there's lots of stuff out there where if you just pay a small fee, you can get what you want. On the YouTube side, I've got a good presentation posted to my website about setting up YouTube channels, so you can look at that. But here's the thing you absolutely need to realize, okay? Your content is sub-licensable, meaning they can license it to anybody else. They could transfer it to anybody else without limitation worldwide. As I said before, those pages could be summarized by, thanks, it's ours. You had this happen to you where they stole your shit.
Actually, yeah. So you're saying that YouTube give up your rights, YouTube owns it, but does that allow any other user to use it without permission?
YouTube, if they use the YouTube player and they want to put it on their website or in their tweet or social media, it's fine. If they paid YouTube to use it, yes. Because so YouTube can go after that. Like if they use a downloader like TubeSock to download it and put it into their video, you could sue them and YouTube can sue them. But if they're using a YouTube player or a YouTube license or their station has an agreement with YouTube, they absolutely can use it. And that's in the terms of service, and it's crap and it's wrong and it's there.
And this is all
correct. Yeah. Podcast, very viable. Podcasts are having a huge comeback. Look at that return in 2 years' time, from 35% consumption to 57% of Americans listening to podcasts. And this is portable versus computer. Let me rephrase that. 27% of Americans are consuming podcasts. 57% of those consuming are doing it on a mobile device. So, mobile delivery and streaming is very important. But when we look at the consumption, we should be at 18% now. Let me see, where are we? 15, 17. It's on track for 20% this year. That's the number. And the bulk of people who listen to podcasts listen to multiple podcasts. So, podcast is another one of those groups that's a very educated group. I say this, look, it's wonderful that we get 5,000 views on an article. But if I can get 1,000 people to spend an hour listening to a podcast, they've received gospel, right? Think about the engagement, the total number of minutes of engagement. Podcasts are longer form engagement. These are your super fans. If any of you are into Marvel Comics, listen to Marvel's podcast. Look at the nerdiness and the geekiness of it, and how deep they go and who comes on as guests. But it is a zeitgeist for connecting with an audience and to see an example of how to take the most passionate in your audience and turn them into a street army of people who will go spread the buzz. Guardians of the Galaxy was a hit, not just because it was a funny, good film, but because the stars were engaging and highly accessible through social media before and when the film came out. Improve linking. Don't put too many links in a blog post. When you do link, consider linking to authoritative sites. Avoid click here links and always put things in there. So we'll do things like if there's a series, hey, there's article number 22 in the series. Did you miss article 21? And at the bottom, there's a subscribe button to get all the articles in the series. Hey, go ahead and link to related content. I've written here about this. Here's another article. Now let me talk to you about this. I'm writing about makeup for men. Here's the benefit of using professional makeup for women for taking pictures. At the bottom, we tell people what to read next. You just read an article on smart objects. Here's three more stories on Photoshop smart objects. By entering good tags and keywords for your articles, your blog platform will automatically suggest articles at the bottom that are popular and relevant. All you and the authors have to do is add the right keywords. And there's even a button that says, "Scan my article and suggest keywords." So it's practically automated. Totally do this. And so now you have a decent chance of getting people to read another article. Encourage cross-linking. Hey, this other article we just published, well, I'm going to keep the conversation going. Here's this. Make a curated reading list. It was Thanksgiving Day. One of my writers followed my advice, and he went in and simply did a post that said, "Holiday photo tips." And he pulled out some of our recent stories about simple portraits, shooting holiday lights, making slideshows, you name it. And just made a reading list of, here's 8 articles that are useful for holiday photos. Did fantastic. The post got tons of reshares. All it did was say, here's a couple of good things, a one-sentence description with a visual. If it was just a list without a visual, it wouldn't have done nearly as well. Making a newsletter. We're launching our newsletter this week, where we handpick 8 good articles. And starting next year, there'll be one original article that only runs in the newsletter. So the only way you get it is subscribe to the newsletter. There's exclusivity. Why? Because an email list is incredibly valuable. An email list with actual contact information for real people, very, very valuable. Now, if you use link shorteners, are you guys familiar with Bitly? Great service to track your links. Makes it very easy to see what's going on. This will give you statistics on your links, so you can see who's clicking, not specifics, but how many times was something clicked. And you can even see if a bunch of it was coming from one website. So if somebody reused your link or article or really popular, you could find your most influential influencers or your allies. And then return the favor by posting some of their content. Share the love. Readability. Make sure that your content is readable. Use headlines. Use subheadlines. Heading level 2s and heading level 3s. I don't use heading level 1s very much. It's the head 2s that are favored for SEO. Use bullets. Add bold. Don't underline things for emphasis because people will think it's a link and they'll sit there clicking on it all day long and they'll get pissed when it doesn't work. Use bold and italics, not underlines. Don't write stupid, cute headlines. The most important, successful articles we have are things like, what the heck is a circular polarizer and why would I use it? How to reduce red eye. How to get the noise out of your photos. Simple, descriptive headlines. Here's a terrible headline from NASA. The NASA person is still in the room? No, left. Good. Cloud computing in the federal government on a cloudy day, how it will astound you. What? Too many words. Why? Who uses the word astound? Why is there an extra space at the beginning here, creating bad layout? There is just nothing right. And why didn't you get it to fit on one line? Look at this terrible orphan here. So the typography person in me hates it. The grammar person in me hates it. There's so many words that I have to read it 3 times for it to make sense. How about the impact of cloud computing on the government? Or NASA's use of cloud computing, lessons learned. Right? This is crappy formatting. This is fantastic formatting. Both are government websites. Okay? Picture. Headings. I love this. they identify, they have a different blogger for each day of the week, and they let you see a little bit about that person. These are all government employees. It's very well done. Categories, exceptionally useful, especially with dates and the ability for people to find things. Use that RSS feed. Every blog makes an RSS feed, real simple syndication. This is an XML feed, extensible markup language. It's automatically generated. It allows people to subscribe. It drives bookmarks. So when people bookmark your website, it will show them any unread articles right there in the bar. They can use it for custom homepages. Flipbook is a great RSS reader for iPad. Pulls all their favorite stories into a digital magazine. Flipboard, I'm sorry. A blog can use it. Podcasts can use it. You can use services to automatically pull your RSS feeds and auto-publish every blog post to your social networks, even introducing delays. So it goes to Twitter 1 hour after the blog goes live, and it goes to Facebook 3 hours after it goes live. And you can stagger that. Twitter feed is a free service, works with Twitter and Facebook, not as robust, but free. And it allows you to connect multiple things. It shows you how many times the links were clicked on. Hootsuite is the granddaddy. Allows you to have teams of people, give them different roles. So you can have people with the ability to write posts, but not publish them. So a manager can review before they can go live. You can upload a spreadsheet with a series of tweets and links to say, hey, I just wrote this great new blog post, and 20 times next year, send out these different things. Now, each tweet has to be slightly different. It can't be identical. It won't let you duplicate, but because it doesn't want to let you spam. But you can get there by adding commas, adding a space, changing a word, and you could set up a year's worth of tweets to reshare that. We have an article about shooting fireworks that I have set up to go out on social media on July 1st for the next decade. Why not? It's useful. I don't want to have to remember to do it. It's an evergreen article. It's a long tail if there ever was one. So this will feed social media and generate posts. Your podcast can have a feed. FeedBurner, strongly recommend. This is a Google service that used to be independent, and this is perfect. So if you ever change platforms, this is like a PO box. So if you change hosting companies and you submitted your feed directly to iTunes and now you switched hosting companies, iTunes has no way for you to swap the source feed. You lose every subscriber and have to start over. They no longer support the redirect command. But if you run it through FeedBurner, you could change the back end. If you have a blog and you make a change, FeedBurner allows you to still keep all your subscribers if you move platforms. FeedBurner also will tell you and optimize things. It could dynamically insert Amazon buy links for any product. It can do crazy things. It can send you an email and text alert anytime your RSS feed has a status problem or a broken compatibility issue. Feed Validator can test your RSS feeds and link to any articles so you can fix problems. The other day, one of my courses on lynda.com broke because it was a weekly course and it got too long. I had the exact same thing happen to a podcast years ago where one of my podcasts stopped delivering because after we got over 100 episodes in the feed, the text file got so long that it hit the character count and iTunes just stopped updating. So we had to start dropping stuff off of the old stuff to what the new stuff was. So you can have RSS feeds that were working perfectly fine that break just because they get too big. So FeedBurner will tell you who's linking, any unusual uses, spikes in traffic, all sorts of stuff. Very interesting. And it allows for other things. Also, always allow email subscribers. Right? 370,000 people have subscribed either through WordPress or through email to get every one of our stories. the number of people that read it on the website is about 10% of the number of people who read my content via email. Now, that's not normal behavior, but my target audience is photographers who are on the go. They would so much rather go to their inbox and read a story that they've already downloaded while they're sitting there than try to load up web pages on the go and search for things. For my audience, email subscriptions are incredibly effective. And once you have them unless they remember to unsubscribe. Our email traffic numbers are killer, and it's great to have. Mobile friendly. Make sure your content is mobile friendly. We're almost done. I'm sorry for running a couple minutes long. WordPress theme or a mobile theme that optimizes for the web. Most people are looking at really small screens. Here's what I see across the board. There are twice as many iOS users as there are Android users. Not when you look at the sales numbers. There are twice as many Android devices sold as there are iOS devices sold. What happens is every single Apple device someone paid for. They chose to get a smartphone. There are lots of people getting Android phones who are getting free phones who don't even bother keeping a data plan, or they kill it after a while, and novel idea. They just use it as a phone. When I talk to companies like Adobe, they see almost 7 to 10 times more downloads of the iOS versions of their apps than they do the Android versions. I don't care which one you use. There are things about both that annoy the shit out of me, and there are things about both that are better than the other one. But iOS devices are in the hands of people who have money, who have been conditioned to spend money. Just remember that. And in my readership, more than 40% are on tablets or mobile phones. I say that a third of our audience is accessing on the go. But the argument could be made that it's really half, right? Some of these are laptops, some of these are mobile, some of these are tablets. It can't tell the difference between desktop and laptop. This is basically saying computer, smartphone, tablet. Mobile has overtaken the desktop, okay? This was in 2014. A great report for ComScore is the US Mobile App Report. This is a free report that you can download. Last year, right, 60% of all traffic was spent on mobile devices. A lot more on apps, and look at desktop. Boom. It was 2013 when desktop lost. I said earlier, you need to start consuming all of your content and websites on mobile devices every day. Every day, look at what looks bad. Look at what broke. Look at what doesn't work. Look at what seems like, my God, how long is this article? It's so freaking long. And start looking at it on mobile devices, because that's how you will be judged. So you can get that at the Mobile App Report. Here's a nice little link shortener if you need it. bit.ly/mobile-app-report, or just search for the US Mobile App Report. Very useful. So you want to look at the device on a tablet. Okay, on a tablet, my website reflows. We went with a Pinterest-style layout. We used to have every blog post you'd have to scroll. Now you can see on my website, you can scroll through a week's worth of articles in about 5 swipes. This makes it really easy for people to see stuff. Tablet ownership is bonkers. Look at that. The number of people who have a tablet is just crazy. Look at that growth. 50% of all Americans have a tablet computer. That's insane. That doesn't mean an iPad. That's just a tablet. E-readers are still pretty popular. Kindles. Now, there was a dip, right? And it's going back down. Because I'm just going to be honest. The Kindle Fire is not a great device. It had potential. Amazon has made much, the Amazon Alexa, the music player, the Echo, is incredible. If you haven't gotten one, they're on sale. They're fantastic. It's like, hey, Alexa, play Foo Fighters. Volume 5. Hey, read me the news. Hey, and any music that you've synced in your library is on this. Everything that I've bought and all sorts of other stuff with my Amazon Prime membership, I can just spew out the type of music I want and it plays it. It's fantastic. They're doing some cool stuff. Their TV is cool. Their tablets kind of suck. And so nobody else is making these, and tablets will spike and then go down, spike and go down. So that's good. On the phone side, it reflows to one article a page. And notice really big visuals. We have a strong visual on every single story to pull you in as you scroll, because people just swipe. We want them to see a story and stop. Smartphones are even crazier than tablets for growth. Infinite dial, 71% of all Americans have a smartphone. That's a lot of people. 192 million people, in fact. Okay? And if you go by age, it's really boomed with younger audiences. But what always happens is this generation gives their old device to this generation or this generation. There's hand-ups or hand-downs that happen all the time. Here's where Android has its problem. Right? This is why BlackBerry is out of business. Only a third of people who have a BlackBerry actually love their BlackBerry. Two-thirds of iPhone users tell other people how incredible it is and brag about their devices. That's why they are actually winning. When you look at the number of sales and this gets splintered across multiple companies, these guys are winning. Use whatever you like. So, that is the 10 ways that I see to improve the distribution of your content. It's a great strategy. To summarize those, and I will make this, I'll make this download available on my website. I have not posted this yet. This is the first time I delivered this presentation, so forgive me for the rough spots and the fact that it ran a few long. Build communities. Make more visuals on your website, including using the tags on those so they're searchable. Bring in additional voices. Supplement your website with guests and other voices, even if it's your own personal website. Allow for social sharing, for deeper engagement and more spreading. Hold live events, including some in-person events. We're doing live photo walks in different cities and just letting people get together in real time. Add more audio and video because people like to read even less than they did before. Improve your linking, including using link shorteners so you can track how your links are doing and who your most influential people are who are sharing those links. Take the time to format your post with good headings and keywords, and this will dramatically improve the searchability and the readability. This is one of the easiest things to do. Use the RSS feed. I have a free thing on my website, a detailed thing about hypersyndication. I also have a class on lynda.com about a concept called hypersyndication. It will walk you through how to use Hootsuite and these other tools to auto-publish. Stop spending all your time publishing to social media and switch all of that effort to responding to people's comments on what you've published. Put all of your publishing effort into your website, minimal effort into publishing original stuff on those networks, and then simply respond to people through social. And lastly, fully embrace mobile, because it is already 40% of my audience today. And it's probably the same for you. It will be the dominant platform within 2 years. So if you need to get in touch, there I am. I've got a couple of cards if you need one. And tomorrow I'll be talking about putting together good presentations and doing a talk in the afternoon about multi-camera of all things. So my brain is weird. But you are welcome to come if you're around for any of those. And if you have any questions, I'll be hanging for a few minutes. So thank you guys for coming out. I'll try to get this posted within a few weeks to my website and to SlideShare. I'll put it in both places so you can find it. Thanks.